This is the day the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Our doxology, praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Call to worship. This is the good news which we proclaim to you.
Jesus Christ is raised from the dead.
Walk in the light of his love.
Live in the light of his teachings and healing mercies.
Come, let us worship the one who overcame death.
Let us celebrate the triumph of our Lord.
May our lives be a testimony to all that he has taught us. Amen. Hymn of praise this morning, hymn number 25. Holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, early in the morning our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
Mighty.
in prayer by Brother Wayne Ross.
Dear God, I'm here again, kneeling at this altar in this sacred place, asked to call on your holy and righteous name. We thank you, dear God, for the many blessings that you've bestowed upon us. We realize that it's not because we've been good, but you've allowed your grace and mercy to come into our lives. For that we thank you. We thank you for the sun that rises and the rain that falls and all of those other things that make life as we know it exist. We thank you, dear God, for watching over us last night as we slept.
Yeah.
You sent your angel to sit by our beds last night and rang our biological alarm clocks early this morning so we could rise and feel like putting on our clothes and coming in out to this edifice one more time. We thank you, dear God, for loving us so much that you'd allow your son, Jesus the Christ, to come in down and be born into a world of sin and die on Calvary's cross so that we may have a right to the tree of life. We ask you, dear God, to bless all of the parishioners that are here today. Bless all of those persons that are under the sound of my weak voice. Bless those persons that are out in cyberspace, the ones that are watching us on YouTube or are looking at us on Facebook. We ask you to bless those as well. We ask you, dear God, to bless all of those persons, parishioners that are part of us that find themselves confined to either hospitals or convalescent homes or rehabilitation stations. We ask you to bless them in a mighty way.
Yes.
Find my friend Abraham Leapheart.
Yes.
Go to his bedside and give him the consolation that you are God and you are God by yourself. And help him to realize that whatever happens to him, you are responsible for it, dear God. And then find Louise Clark. We miss her here today. We ask you to find her wherever she is. Boost the spirits. Bring her back to worship with us again. We ask a special blessing for my son-in-law. He's a young person and finding himself in a very, very precarious situation where he can't get around and walk and can't do the things that he's normally has to do as far as his job is concerned. Bring him back to health and let him know that God is on his side.
Yeah.
Go to all of the hospitals, all of them, and bless all of those people that need your blessing. We realize that we have people here that have aches and pains. We have people that have marital problems. We have people that have money problems. We have all kind of problems right in our midst. Go out and bless us and take care of those problems if it's thy will, dear God. And then we ask you to speak for the speaker today. Put the words in her mouth that'll cut sin on the like a sword, a two-edged sword on the left and the right. Help her to to bring the word to us today, something that's going to be filling for us for the week, all of next week. And then, dear God, when finally we've prayed our last prayer and sang our last song, when we too must cross over the River Jordan to the other side, we ask you, dear God, to give us a home in thy kingdom, where Job said that we could should cease from trouble. It's your humble service prayer. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Raw, for that heartfelt prayer this morning. It's nothing like prayer. Amen. And as I stand, I want to say thank you to everyone, even in Facebook land, that prayed for me. Amen. It was hard, but God brought me through. God is so good. And I even though I could say back then God is good, God is even more good to me now. Amen. Amen. The scripture today comes from 1 John, the first chapter, verses 1 through 2. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled, caring concerning the word of life. The life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested to us. 1 John, the second chapter. My little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, thank you, Lord, the righteous. And he himself is our propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the whole world. God's word to the people of God. Amen. Now we have a musical selection from the Voices of New Bethel, and our ushers will come to collect our benevolent tithes and offerings. And a prayer, offertory prayer. Then when we go to our announcements by Sister Patera Martin, and then our pastor will come forth with her words, Reverend Dr. Elaine Johnson Eskew.
Thank you.
may not know there are some places I can't go, but I am sure of this one thing: my God is real. Some fails may scorn, all can desist and leave me alone. But as for me, I'll take God's part, for God is real.
Father God, we thank you for this offering. We thank you, God, for each and every person that gave in this offering. We thank you, God, even for those that didn't have it to give at this time. But we know, God, that they will be able to provide an offering in the next offering. We thank you, God, and we praise you for allowing us to be in another service today. All things come of thee, O Lord.
Good morning, New Bethel.
Good morning.
Glad to see everybody on this first Sunday in April. Do we have any visitors? Are you Miss Vanessa Cleckley? Okay. I'm going to run through the announcements and then I'll let you introduce yourself. Okay. All right, so next Sunday is Autism Awareness Sunday, so you should wear your blue. You are invited to celebrate with the Columbia Conference YPD for the Emerald Gala and Fashion Show. It's Saturday, April 27th at 3:00 at the Ruth C. Simon Family Life Center. There's dinner, fashion show, and dessert. Tickets are $10, and you can see a YPD member for those. It's a black tie commencement gala for the Midlands Primary Learning Center. They are celebrating 15 years of educational excellence. Saturday, the 27th of April at 7:00, excuse me, 7 to 11, so it's a party, at Venue 817, and that's 817 St. Andrews Road, Suite 101. Tickets are $60 per person, and table sponsorship is $500. That was a good deal, wasn't it? $500, which includes complimentary wine. So if you are interested in sponsoring a table or purchasing a ticket, I have applications here. You can see me after service. The community is having a blood drive. Our blood saves lives. Donate today. It's going to be Wednesday, April the 24th from 3 to 7 at Pleasant Hill Baptist Church. And they also have a QR code where you can sign up online. I have that as well after church if you need it. It's that time of year again. The New Bethel Foundation will be participating in Midlands Give. This is our 9th year participating. The first Tuesday in May, there's 18 hours of online giving. So you can create your own list of donors for the New Bethel Foundation, or you can reach out to a board member, and those members are Brother Bernard Gilliard, Sister Barbara Rawls, Reverend Dr. Elaine Eskew, Sister Jenny Simpkins, Reverend Dr. Odell Glenn, Mr. Freddie Black, and Miss Marilyn Davis. The Columbia Area YPD Mission Project will be meeting on Saturday, May the 18th. They'll be supporting the Palmetto Place Children and Youth Services. They are asking all the churches in the Columbia area to prepare 4 clear bags of 5 items in each. They will need items for boys and girls ages 15 to 21. If you would like to donate more than that, they would appreciate it. But bring the bags to the educational meeting on May the 18th at 10 a.m. at Bishop Memorial AME, and that's 2221 Washington Street. The items listed, so when you're shopping, you might want to grab a few, are deodorant, toothpaste, hair combs, lotion, toothbrushes, hair brushes, mouthwash, shampoo, soap, and conditioner. Greetings, pastors, church, and community leaders. I greet you with the blessed hope that your parishes and communities are thriving. One significant goal of the Lexington branch, and I think this is of the NAACP, is to support the education of our youth while promoting freedom, justice, and equality. The Lexington branch will be offering scholarships to eligible students of Lexington County. There's included a list of details attached, and you can contact Mr. James Gates, the president, if you are interested. And Ms. Ethel, is this from you? I think you can see Sister Ethel Corley for more information after church. And then my last announcement is from Sister Erica Rhett. The Lay Day Sunday will be April 28th during morning service. The speaker has yet to be announced. She is asking for everyone to contribute $10 and wear royal blue, navy blue, or blue and white. She thanks everyone in advance for their cooperation. And now I'm going to turn it over to Miss Francie Cleckley.
Good morning, good morning. Thank you so much for letting me be here to worship today. My name is Francie Cleckley, and I'm running for a state senate seat. That is District 10, and portions of Lexington is included in that. I was born and raised in Bennettsville, South Carolina, but I have lived my entire adult life in Lexington. I am not a career politician, but I am a career civil servant where I worked 36 and a half years to support taxpayer advocacy through the federal government. I've dealt with Congress at the national level. I believe I have the skills and experience to represent us at the State House. And when I say us, I believe that what's going on at our State House does not include women and minorities. And so we have to have better representation at the State House in things like women's reproductive rights, sensible gun laws, accessible, affordable child care for all. And the fact that our leadership in this legislature turns away federal money, Medicare money, to Medicaid money to feed our children and to provide health care for the lower income folks, I find to be unacceptable. And so the only way to fix that is for someone like me to run and everyone here to get out and vote to try to make a difference. I will be available outside to chat with you after the service, but again, thank you. I have some social media. I'd love for you to follow me and friend me on Facebook. I have some cards that have a connection to all that. Thank you again for letting me be here.
Thank you so much for visiting, Ms. Clayton. In my rush, I forgot to ask, are there any birthdays this week? Okay, anyone else?
My granddaughter's was yesterday.
Okay, mm-hmm. Let's go ahead and sing. Oh, and Miss Polly. Okay, well, let's sing to these members.
Happy birthday to you. May God bless you. Happy birthday to you. May God bless you.
Oof, Good morning. Truly, it's good to be here today. And Sister Louise wanted me to make sure her church members knew exactly where she is. Had an excellent visit with her on yesterday, and Sister Barbara led us in prayer via telephone. Louise says she is coveting you all's prayers. She's at Lexington Medical Center, not in the North Tower, 9109. Right now, her phone isn't charged, but she's working on that. But she says she really love for you all to visit if you're able, and if you can't, just pray for her. And you all know how Louise love a telephone. And she was so happy to hear she called so many names, but the only person I called yesterday was Sister Barbara Rock, and she said she really, Sister Barbara, always keep up with her every week, all the time. So she wanted her to know exactly where she was, that she is in upbeat and doing well. So if Sister Louise is watching, if someone's there to get her on, Sister Louise, we love you. We're praying for you. We also, I'm trying to slowly get around to making visits. We went to visit Mother Jones, and Sister Connie promised me some pictures, so Connie sent me my pictures. She and the baby. The baby fell in love with Mother Jones. I mean, he grinned at her, he crawled, he wanted to take her shoes, and it was just such an honor to see our little baby, who's 11 months old, with Mother Jones, who is 100, will soon be 105. And she was making some more little baskets for our children here at New Bethel. She said it was a couple more children. Sister LaDaris told her it was more than 25. And so she was hard working when we arrived at her kitchen table by the window making baskets for the youth. So if you need another basket, let Sister Connie know now. And so they're starting for next year's gifts for the children. And also, it's been a blessing. We have a few more places to go. We're slowly making it. But God is good, and my thoughts is to continue to pray one ye for another, all of us. And I say it week after week. We're doing pretty good this week, but we don't know what next week will bring. Amen? We don't know. Now, do we have any children that's graduating from high school? Huh? Your Sandra's grandson is graduating.
Sean King.
Will you stand up, Shanice? You're so quiet. Okay, now we need you to wear your robe one Sunday where we can take your picture in your robe. Will your grandson be home before graduation? Okay, and I think we have several college graduates, but wear your robe. Now, Sister Barbara, I heard it through the grapevine. Her grandson is also graduating from Clemson on May the 11th. And my grandson, who's back in the back, he's graduating from USC May the 4th. So God is good. He's blessing us. Any more college graduates? Baby, you have two? From where? Dartmouth?
Dartmouth.
Oh, okay. What's her name? Okay, all right. So God is blessing us here at New Bethel and our children and grandchildren. So we ask that you keep them in prayer. It's tough being a young person now. It's tough being an old person, but it's real tough being a young person. Amen. So God is good. And as I said earlier, pray one ye for another. One ye for another. Amen. All right. Okay, let's turn it back over to the choir. And I shared with Brother Tony, no surprises from Pastor today. Amen. Amen. All right.
Put your hands together. Songwriter says, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Should we do it? Do do do. Lean.
right there if you need.
God is good. God is good. First, get around to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is the head of my life, to all of New Bethel and those of you that's visiting with us, as well as those of you at home on the various social media platforms. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Oh God, our Father, I simply ask that you anoint me afresh. From the crown of my head to the soles of my feet, in Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
The scripture that was read for your hearing, I want to read it once again. The word of life, this is first epistle of John, and I'll be reading just a couple of verses. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, have touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. The life was made manifest, and we have seen it, testified to it, and proclaimed to you the eternal life, which was with the Father, was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard and proclaimed to you. Proclaim to you so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that your joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him proclaimed to you, that God is light and in him no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. The blood of Jesus, his son, cleansed us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to clean us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Chapter 2, verse 2. My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus the Christ, the righteous. He is a propitiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Chosen for a title, with God on your side and his word in your heart, everything will be all right. On this second Sunday of Easter, actually this is the second Sunday of Easter, John is writing to us because a lot has happened. And I'm going to have to do a little background to kind of get all of us together. John had a purpose for writing the epistles. We know that John was the beloved disciple. Amen. And John is telling us the only way we can have fellowship with God and with one another is through Jesus the Christ and the work that he did on Calvary's cross. Now, it was a lot going on, a whole lot. And this whole first epistle, first and second chapter of the epistle, is talking about how fellowship with the Word of God, is life to us. And the backdrop from it is through church history. I shared with my husband as I was studying this and with my daughter, I had to go back to seminary for this one. Amen. So we're talking about John wrote this particular, these epistles after Jerusalem was destroyed by the Rome, by the Romans in the year 70. John left Jerusalem and moved to the city of Ephesus in Western Asia Minor in what is now considered Turkey. And if you hear some of these, it's all of this kind of play into what is going on in the world today, amen. And by the time John has written this, Peter and Paul were dead, and many of the other apostles were dead. And long before John died, before John, and John was the last one left. You know, and John, in all of his epistles, he always called, referred to God's followers, Jesus' followers, as his little children. And he was so, it was such a burden on his spirit that we wouldn't, they wouldn't have false teaching and allow it to rule and reign in their lives. And so what John wanted them to know is that I've been around a long time. In fact, they referred to him as the elder, the old man. That's what they actually called him. And like Miss Polly, this last week we saw on Facebook where your daughter proudly proclaimed, "Mama is 83 years old and doing well." Amen. Amen. Well, they was referring to him as the old man, and that meant he had wisdom, he had life experience. But what he wanted to know above all, and historians, biblical historians, believe that he was in his 80s when he actually penned these epistles. And he was busy going around teaching everyone he knew. And the main thing he was fighting against, people could not understand how Jesus, how God could come in the flesh of human Jesus, and how he could die and be resurrected. And so one of the main teachers, along with Polycarp and some others, they were all teaching that, yes, and if you hear this, you think about some teaching out of here. Yes, Jesus was a good man. He was ordained by God. And he was, when he was baptized, it was a special gift came upon him. But once he went to the cross, what they were teaching is, at that point when he died, he was just a regular old man that died. Well, that disturbed John, because John knew in his spirit that Jesus was the Son of God. John couldn't explain exactly how it happened, but by faith, he knew without a shadow of a doubt. When Jesus went to the cross, he went to the cross for the sins of the whole world. It wasn't just a temporary thing. It lasts for all eternity. And so what John wanted us to know, and it's still relevant today. So for the next couple of weeks, I, along with so many other pastors that teach and preach, that fellowship with God is the only way. And we know that Jesus walked the face of the earth even after his death, burial, and resurrection. And then the Holy Spirit came. Then the Holy Spirit came. And John wanted us to know that if we don't cultivate our relationship with God and with each other, it's the only way we can have joy, peace, in our salvation. So John knew that Jesus was indeed flesh and blood. He was indeed God in the flesh. He was Christ in himself. And if we as Christians, we can't cut and paste and believe what we want to believe. We have to take the whole Jesus the Christ or none at all. Amen. Amen. So that's why we don't even waste our time arguing about the Word of God. We simply spend time in the Word as we went through Lent and then Advent. And now, we're working on our relationship. And see, in his gospel, he let us know that was read earlier that yes, all of us have sinned. And if we say we haven't, then we make the Word of God. See, John understood that the Word was so important to our way of life. The Word of God is what brings us out of the dark and places us into the marvelous light. The Word of God. And those of you who studied the Gospel of John, most of us, when we first accepted Christ as personal Savior, whoever was your Christian leader, your teacher, your Sunday school teacher, they shared with you, read the Gospel of John. Get to know Jesus in an intimate way. Get to know him in all his humanity. So he started his epistle about the Word of God. It's life. It's life. The Word was in the beginning, and the beginning was with God. The Word of God. So John is going right back over the teachings. The teachings in the Gospels, and particularly in John, have an intimacy with God. So this week, we start with working on our intimate relationship with God. How many of you, I don't hold up your hands, have had an intimate relationship with a husband, significant other, good friends? Amen. But you have to cultivate that relationship. It just doesn't happen instantaneously. You have to cultivate it. You get to know the person. You know what they like. You know what they don't like. Amen. When you go into a store, the shop, you know exactly what will make them happy. Your children, even your little children, you know what foods they like to eat, and you prepare those. Well, this is what John is saying. If we want to cultivate a relationship with God the Father, we must get to know his word and understand why Jesus came. Why he gave his life, and why he says, I'm coming back again. I'm coming back again. And yet, as we celebrate the church year, we know that in so many days, we'll celebrate Pentecost, the Holy Spirit. And so every year as a church family, as Christians, we join so many Protestant denominations throughout the world. Well, we walk this year, the Christian year, the year, and we all reflect on the next few weeks, getting to know, be reintroduced to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the tenets of the faith. I get excited. I can remember when I did my initial sermon and Reverend Gates, Sylvia Gates, well, Moore, she had gone through before I did, and I said, oh boy, we're getting ready for these classes. Sylvia, what is it about the classes? She said, Elaine, when you go through the Board of Examiners, the class on admissions is where you re-fall in love with the AME Church and Jesus' role in the AME Church. And I thought she was joking, but as I studied for the first year, and then it ended up being 5 years altogether, I understood what she meant. When you have an intimate relationship with the Lord, no matter what come your way, no matter what struggles you have in life, you know, hallelujah, it's going to be all right. For my Facebook friends, you all know, my song for the week was, if God had it not been for the Lord on my side. And I believe in my sanctified spirit. That's what John was saying to the church. Church, yes, he's gone, but he did rise. He was not just a good fella. He was Jesus the Christ, who came down for your sins and for my sins. And with him, you could have life and have it more abundantly. You can have joy, unspeakable joy. You would no longer be comfortable living in the dark. If it had not been for the Lord on my side, that's what John said. Everybody else died. All of the other, the high rollers, those who was with Jesus. But I alone am left to tell the story. Why? Because I walked in love. I walked in love. Love conquers a multitude of sin. And as we continue to read God's word, we'll see that John, the beloved disciple, the beloved disciple was there on the Isle of Patmos all alone. But he was not alone because he was walking in the light. When you walk in the light, thou shalt know the fellowship of love, and the Holy Spirit can be bestowed upon you and you reign in the light above. Now, when I first started preaching, I ended every sermon with this word. And this is the rest of the story. Some of you old folks know who used to say that, right? Paul Harvey, when he ended his story. So this is the rest of the story for today. But for the next 4 weeks, we're going to fall in love all over again. And you know, we're going to have goosebumps. And I know you have it now when you pray. Yesterday, when Sister Barbara was praying with Sister Louise and myself, Sister Louise, my hands are so weak, but when I knew anything, Sister Louise had grabbed my hand, and she was shaking my hand. Amen. God is good. Amen. See, when you know that the Lord is on your side, right, you can face whatever challenges come your way. Amen. You might be down and out. You might be 105 pounds, but that's all right, because you know the Lord's Lord is on your side. And that's what John, the beloved disciple, was teaching us. Walk in love. Fall in love with God. When you fall in love with God, you accept his son Jesus as your personal Savior and allow the Holy Spirit to live in your life. If you get right with him, you'll be all right with everybody else. That was simple, John's message. Go back and read each one of the epistles. Love. Most of these little children here, you can insult them today, they'll be all right tomorrow. Amen. Why? Because they know what love is. I always tell people, if I'm real sick, Brother Harold, you get me a young person to pray for me. Amen. I don't mean no harm. Us old people, we all right, but we got long memories. But little Bella can come and act up, but little Bella, when she pray, she'll meet it from her heart. Why? Because she's a little child. And see, that's what John says. We have to become like little children and walk in love. Love. If you want joy, walk in love. If you feel lonely, walk in love. Yeah. And guess what? What you give out is what it comes back. Yeah. Amen. 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 I thought about you, Miss Potter, last night if we was at a singing program. And I don't know where we was at. Prosperity somewhere up in the country. And it was an 83-year-old fella. That man danced so, Miss Potter, I said, Lord have mercy. If
if I could jump around like him. But he shared his testimony. I thought about Brother Vernon and his sister, and Thomasine and Thomas, and Ronnie and Lonnie. So his mother had two sets of twins. All of them died, except for him. And they told his family he would only live, 6 months. And he was jumping around at 83. He said he knew. But he knows in his heart what God can do. Mm-hmm. What God can do when we sell out to him. Mm-hmm. So New Bethel, sell out to the Lord. Not going to be perfect. You're going to keep making mistakes. Mm-hmm. But that's all right. Amen. We have an advocate with the Father. Jesus is making intercession for us. Purpose in your heart to fall in love with Jesus all over again. Some of us, if we've been married a long time, we said, they asked, would you marry that person again? And some of us can truly say, we've been through a lot. And yes, I do it all over again. So that's what I want you to do today. As the choir leader sent an invitation, Christ is not the center of your life. I ask that you rest on the doors of the church are open. If you're not sure that you're in Christ's center, if for some reason, if you know that for some reason that you're not in right fellowship, I ask that you
Hallelujah. God is good. Y'all forgive me my allergies. Ooh, glory to God. You do truly and earnestly repent of your sins and in love and charity with your neighbor and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth into his holy ways. Draw near with faith by taking this holy sacrament to your comfort, by making your confession, by standing, if you're able, to Almighty God, if you're able to stand. And let us repeat the general confession together. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word, and deed against your divine majesty, provoking most justly your wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent and heartily sorrow for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please you in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of your great mercies have promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto you, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness and bring us to everlasting life through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom all no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts and the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. It is very meet and right and our bounden duty that we shall at all times and all places give thanks unto you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your holy name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, 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 holy Lord God of hosts. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Glory be to you, Most High. We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather the crumbs under your table, your table, but you are the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful souls and bodies may be made clean by his death and washed through his blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Prayer of confession, consecration has already been prayed. We've asked the Lord to bless this body and blood. And as we prepare to take it together as one body, I ask each one to, the body which was broken for you, eat it with thanksgiving in your heart. The blood that was shed on Calvary's cross for the sins of the whole world. We drink it for thanksgiving. Let us repeat the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, which art in heaven, Holy is your name. Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done
on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we'll sing a song of fellowship. Amen. Bless you. I will not be hugging today because of these allergies. Mm-hmm. Love, smile at each other, do a bump bump. Amen. God is good, and God is good. Mm-hmm. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Henceforth and forevermore, and the people of God says,